Mad, Bad, and Dangerous to Know. Written and read by Ranulph Fiennes. The Guinness Book of Records described me as the youngest posthumous baronet. This unwanted claim to fame came about because my father, another Ranulph, was killed during the Italian campaign in the Second World War, 4 months before my birth. In June 1943, he came home on leave and I was conceived. When he left, my mother was never to see him again. My grandmother, Florrie, had lost her elder son in the First World War. Now she had lost her younger son, and her husband had also died. So, as soon as the war was over, she decided to return to her own family in South Africa. My mother, three elder sisters, and I were wafted along in her wake. But soon after she died, in October 1950, we returned to England, and I was packed off to my new English prep school in a purple blazer and cap and grey flannels. About the time of my 12th birthday, my mother purchased St. Peter's Well, a long, low house on the edge of the village of Lodsworth in Sussex. Right across the front garden wall, as far as the eye could see, stretched a paradise of fields, valleys, and forest. The river Lod ran along the bottom of our valley. A month before our own arrival, a family of five settled in the hamlet of River, a mile from Lodsworth. Mr. Pepper ran a chalk pit at Amberley. There were two sons about my age and a daughter of nine, 3 years my junior, named Virginia. Common entrance exams came and went. I passed with just sufficient marks to make it into Eton. My mother, proud and delighted, drove me down, the Morris Minor laden with suitcases. At prep school, my baronetcy and my South African background had proved good for my street cred, but here baronets were trashy non-entities, eclipsed by a welter of earls, lords, and viscounts. I had been at Eton about a month when two older boys entered my room just before lunchtime. "They say that you're a tart, Fiennes. Did you know?" "What," I asked them, "is a tart?" But they giggled together and wouldn't tell me. Eventually, I discovered that in Eton slang, a tart is a boy who sells himself for sexual activities in return for favours, be they in cash or kind. There could be no lower form of life. I didn't realise that any pretty boy at Eton is going to be labelled a tart, and that gossip is based not on what actually happens, but on what the gossipers would like to think has happened. My tormentors were unremitting. I seriously contemplated throwing myself off the bridge over the Thames, only restrained by the thought of making my mother suffer. Instead, I decided to cultivate a perpetual scowl and to join the school boxing team. But nothing could alter my girlish face. Boys had crushes on me, and the verbal torment continued. Fortunately, time was on my side. Each term brought a fresh crop of pretty faces to distract the gossips. Slowly, I began to enjoy one or two aspects of Eton life, especially after meeting Michael Denny, who was a prefect in Mr. Crusoe's house. Since neither Denny nor I was an experienced climber, it's difficult to conjure up exactly why we began to climb together, but somehow the partnership was formed. As a result, my last 18 months at Eton included a good deal of nocturnal excitement. There is nothing new about stegophily, a dictionary term for the practice of climbing buildings by night. The beauty of it is that the thrill of danger is present without the full visual impact of the drop below. Denny and I hoisted assorted dustbins or lavatory seats to various prized pinnacles and watched with secret pleasure while steeplejacks with ropes and long ladders brought them back down again. As my time at Eton drew to a close, I had to decide on my future. But there had really only ever been one career choice. One day I would be commanding officer of the Royal Scots Greys, just like my father. But family connections were no longer a pass into the army. Now, to enter the Royal Military Academy of Sandhurst, you needed at least 2 general certificates of education at advanced level, including mathematics or physics, and 5 certificates at ordinary level. This precluded any chance of my becoming a professional officer by the normal route. But there was a possible alternative, to obtain a short service commission through Mons Officer Cadet School, and once in the army on a 2-year commission, to try to extend. Even for Mons, however, I would need a minimum of 5 ordinary level passes, and nearly 5 years of Eton had only gained me 4. After consultation with my housemaster, my mother told me the wonderful news that I could leave Eton at the end of the summer term and enrol in a specialist crammar abroad. One Saturday, I went to the Lodsworth Village Flower Show, where my mother had great hopes for her marrow entries. As I wandered off, I noticed a slim girl of about 13 wearing a blue and white skirt and a sports shirt with short sleeves. I was sure God had never designed any girl so perfectly. I sat on an onion display and watched her. "Isn't it wonderful?" This was my mother. "Oh, yes," I said. My mother looked at me, surprised and pleased, for I didn't normally enthuse over her vegetables. She had won a prize, and so, both elated, we headed back to the Morris Minor. She stopped in the car park to chat with the occupant of the next car. It was Mrs. Pepper, and beside her sat the vision. "This is Virginia," said Mrs. Pepper. "Remember her? She's back from Eastbourne for half term." The girl smiled politely at my mother and looked briefly at me with total unconcern. My first cousin, Greville Gubby Napier, had involved himself with a fuzzy-haired beauty with long legs, so I went alone to a party at Lys on the Vespa scooter which my mother had given me for Christmas. 2 of the girls there decided to raid their old school, a nearby mansion where Dame Margaret Rutherford had recently filmed The Happiest Days of Your Life. The entire party, armed with fireworks and smoke bombs, drove an assortment of motorbikes, sports cars and old bangers to Bicolour School for young ladies. The raid was a noisy success, but my girlfriend of the evening was a bad scooter passenger, and by the time we tailed the marauding cavalcade to the gates, the lodgekeeper had collected his wits and taken my number. 2 days later, the police called at Lodsworth. I was to be prosecuted for malicious damage. None of the other raiders was caught, and at the Midhurst Court sessions, the proceedings were dropped after I had apologised to the headmistress and paid her £8.03 and 6 to replace an eiderdown burnt by a smoke bomb. However, the national newspapers were hard up for news and made tasty headlines out of a mixture of Bomber Baronet, Screaming Young Girls in Nightdresses, and Margaret Rutherford. My mother was at her wit's end, wondering where it would all lead. What might I not get up to if let loose in France? She decided to find a language school rather nearer home and enrolled me, aged 17, at a crammar in Hove. Virginia Pepper kept 2 ponies at her father's chalk quarry at Amberley, and one of my sisters got Mrs. Pepper's permission for me to help exercise them. Ginny and I rode by way of woodland paths and long fallow fields which we both knew well. One day, before we rode back, I gave Ginny a scarf which I had bought especially for her. I watched as she opened the wrapping, and when I saw her smile, the whole world danced. We left the ponies in the paddock and went in for tea. I learnt that Ginny was going back to school in Eastbourne the following day, so I nonchalantly offered her a lift on my Vespa. To my surprise and delight, her mother agreed. Ginny had a small suitcase which fitted on the rear seat, and when she kept well forward, I felt her pressed against my back and her hands lightly around me. I was in heaven. In fact, if heaven is half as good as I felt that day, it will be worth the struggle to attain. All went well as far as the school where we dropped off her suitcase. She had agreed to have tea with me in the town, but on our way back I swerved to avoid a bicyclist. I don't remember the accident, nor the next 15 hours. When I woke up in hospital, the nurse told me that my passenger was in her bed at her school, my scooter was in good nick, and the bicyclist, whose fault it had been, was unharmed. Apart from concussion and abrasions, I too was undamaged. I was fined £4 for riding a scooter without L-plates and carrying an unlicensed passenger, and Ginny's father, who had never liked me, was furious and forbade her to see me again. Thus encouraged, we agreed to meet by night in a bathroom at her school. For 2 hours I sat in the bath, and Ginny, in her nightdress, sat on the loo. My cautious suggestion that we could perhaps make ourselves more comfortable were discouraged, and I was determined not to risk alarming her. Towards the end of term, and daringly by day, I waited for Ginny with a bunch of other girls on their way back from La Crosse. She recognised me, despite the scooter helmet and goggles, and dropped behind the others. We hid in a patch of rhododendrons. "You are wicked," she laughed. We kissed for the first time, and I felt that I'd love her forever. It was the time of the mini-skirt, or pussy-pelmet, and the crammer was full of sexy foreign girls. This impeded my concentration, and I never got my language A-levels. But I did net a German O-level, which brought my tally up to 5 and qualified me to attempt the Army's Regular Commissions Board, where I was put through a series of aptitude tests more taxing on the imagination and physique than the intellect. To my delight, I passed. The next step was Mons Officer Cadet School in Aldershot. Despite being discovered night-climbing a local girls' school, for which I was awarded 56 days of restrictions of privileges, I did scrape through the exams. So, in February 1963, I made my way to Germany to join the Royal Scots Greys. I was 18. When no tank exercises were anticipated, there was an army budget available for adventure training, and on the strength of this, I received permission to train the regimental cross-country ski team and to form a canoe club, taking groups of jocks down different rivers for training exercises. I was about to apply for a one-year extension to my short service commission when I spotted a three-line advertisement in regimental orders. Officers wishing to apply for secondment to the 22nd Special Air Service should obtain the relevant form from the orderly office. I left the Royal Scots Greys in December, assuring my friends that I would be back in 3 years' time. In February, I drove to Bradbury Lines in Hereford and through a security gate to the barracks of the SAS. Altogether, 124 would-be SAS troopers and 12 other officers congregated in the barracks for the selection month. The first night's activities included a naked swim across the River Wye in temperatures below freezing. There was a great deal of map-reading and fast cross-country movement and very little sleep. SAS staff with binoculars seemed to be everywhere. Any form of cheating led to dismissal from the course. Eventually, I passed the selection, and in late February 1966, the CO of the SAS, Lieutenant Colonel Mike Wingate Gray, awarded 3 officers and 12 men their buff-coloured SAS berries and sea-blue stable belts. Since all SAS officers are ranked captain or above, I missed out on the rank of first lieutenant and became the youngest captain in the army at that time. But not for long. The selection course proved merely a warm-up to the next 4 months of intensive training. Halfway through, I found out that I had glandular fever, so I was dispatched home to recover. A few weeks later, I ran into an old Eton friend, William Knight, who wanted to register a protest at the way 20th Century Fox, in order to film the adventures of Dr. Doolittle, was desecrating a trout stream that ran through the picturesque village of Castle Coombe. With an opportune supply of explosives, I was to mount the diversion which would draw away the security patrol, and I was also to alert a friendly journalist to cover the story. The diversionary flares did their stuff, but my tame journalist shopped us to the Daily Mirror. They in turn informed the police, who were lying in wait. Considering I could have gone to jail for 7 years, the fine of £500 plus costs and legal fees at the subsequent court case was an intense relief. But I was immediately expelled from the SAS, and I realised that I would no longer achieve my dearest wish. The Royal Scots Greys might not want a convicted arsonist for their commanding officer. Ginny was another casualty of the Castlecombe affair, for her father, believing she had obtained my explosives from his Sussex chalk quarry, immediately...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.